Hi, I'm Alec Newman. I think they've got me down here for Frank Herbert's Dune and Assassin's Creed. But done another few bits and pieces as well, so.
What's been your favourite sort of character to play and what sort of project's been...
I knew you were going to ask me that. the answer is I really have no idea. I would have to say that not just because it's come back, but... playing Paul Atreides in Dune, in the miniseries in 2000, and then again in 2003 with the sort of sequel miniseries Children of Dune, which is the second and the third book. The older I get, the more, I don't want to say important, but kind of I will, the more important that seems to feel, simply because there have been various attempts to remake that story since we finished the second miniseries. And eventually they've arrived with Denis Villeneuve's version. And so what I've realized is you become part of the story is so timeless. In the same way that Shakespeare is, you know, people do it over and over and over because the story is so brilliant. I think Herbert was way ahead of his time when he wrote those novels. He might have been way ahead of his own brain for various reasons, which we can't discuss on camera as well. But, you know, it's a Messiah story, and I got to play it all the way through. I got to play the character through to the preacher when he, you know, comes back from the deep desert and complete with prosthetics to make you look sort of 200 years old or whatever it is. And I'm very proud of that. And it's almost like the older I get, the more proud of it I become. Be very interesting to see what Villeneuve and Chalamet and all the rest of the team do as they progress through the stories, because there is a pull. The more you do, the more story you want to tell, because he wrote, I think, 6 books. It does get less and less filmable as you move through the books. You know, you've got people turning into sandworms, which, you know, with all the best CG in the world, you've got to have a really strong concept to make that work. So it'd be interesting to see how far they get and whether Chalamet will be able to play the preacher anytime soon, because he's very much in the... I haven't seen the new Dune movie because I want to wait for the second one and watch them together and watch the first novel. But I'd love to see them continue, you know. So I think Dune was sort of the big one. I had no idea when we were making it. I was 25. I was full of nonsense. I didn't know what we were doing. You know, I was like, this is great, yeah. But as I get, you know, as I get a little older, I appreciate it more, I think. And Dark Shadows as well, a similar thing. And it was really sad for all of us that we didn't get to continue, because what happened there was that the executives at the top of the WB channel all changed. And when new people come in, they go, right, these are my ideas. You know, let's get rid of all your ideas. And that was that. But again, an iconic character that I have no doubt will return in some form of fashion, you know. Yeah.
We talked about the absolutely sensational success of Cyberpunk, and
yes,
particularly Edgerunners, the series, and
yeah,
the magnificent Adam Smash.
Thank you. I video games just in general have taken me by surprise. When I first started doing voices in video games, it was a real sidebar for me. And what I've realized is that the video games industry is bigger than movies, TV and music put together, and consequently the level of people's excitement about certain projects, and Cyberpunk is a brilliant example, is equivalent. And Adam Smasher, I voiced 4 characters, and Adam Smasher was the one that I had the least idea of. They didn't have an image for the character. They said he's kind of a cyborg, and he's completely mental. So I said, well, what do you want me to do? You know, and we tried a few voices, and the director picked the voice that that he, Justin Villiers, I think, that he felt was the most suitable. And yeah, it was a real surprise to come back and voice Adam Smasher again in the animated series, having sort of seen what they did with it, you know, in sequences from the game. I actually bought the game, but I never played it because I bought it when it was really buggy. Oh, no. So I think I took it back and got FIFA instead, or something. And yeah, it's just that thing about the you know, you can't monitor the hours that people play these games for. And so they get very, their attachment to the character is equivalent to having watched a movie or a piece of television 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 times. So I'm gobsmacked by the success of some of these games. I think that kind of part of the work, we weren't really allowed to mess with the lines. I've learned to ask with games. Movies and TV, sometimes, you know, it's between you and the director. Occasionally you have to ask the studio, can we change this? And they'll usually say yes. Games, no. You say, can I say this instead? And 9 times out of 10, there's a big pause from the desk while they kind of go, how do we tell this actor that he has to say what's written, you know? With Cyberpunk, that kind of work came in, particularly with Smasher, the Adam Smasher character, just finding ways to elevate the lines that they had written, you know, maybe different stresses or, you know, but changing dialogue and improvising, it's tricky in games because some of the time you have to fit the line into a certain time limit for the cue. And some of the time there's just no room on the track to, you know, I mean, believe me, I love improvising. I would be off and running, you know, but, it's very technical. So the trick is to make it not sound technical. Voicing video games, and this was true with Cyberpunk, like most of them, you have to come up with something very quick. And I always defer to the director. I'll give them something that I'm comfortable and confident doing, and allow them to choose, you know. It's a very open process. But once you've decided on what the voice is and what you're going to do, then you can go to town because you've already been given the permission, you know. So I love it. You know, you can go in like dressed in rags or your pajamas. No one will know. Yeah, just realizing how big that industry is, from where I was when I started doing the video game stuff, you've got to have respect for that. It's a big industry, so it's fun to be part of it.
I'd just like to talk about your time on the Star Trek set. And,
yeah.
You know, it's great being one of my personal favourites. And yeah. It's a super, super episode.
Oh, great. Glad you liked it.
And that, you know, just to recall your time on the set and things like that, you know, was it...
I Libby Goldstein... I was in LA at the time. I was doing auditions for this, that, and the other, and Star Trek was one. I kind of thought, well, I'm never going to get this, so I may as well just go for something fairly manic while I'm here, you know. And they liked it, so obviously it's shot at Paramount. I think I had done Angel by then, so I was sort of in this weird position of being a Brit in Hollywood. But when I drove up to Paramount for the first day on Star Trek, they were like, welcome back. I was like, this is amazing, you know. It was very difficult to remain cool, you know, driving into the gates of Paramount, going, yeah, sure, you know. Brilliant thing about that was Brent Spiner was in that story thread. There were three episodes. A perfect gentleman. He was the only cast member that was allowed to drive his car onto the lot. We all had to use the car park. I'm a massive fan of The Wrath of Khan. So obviously the Malik character is a kind of, I think many people are, it's really where those early Star Trek movies peaked for me, I think. You know, the little creature in the ear and, you know, Ricardo Montalban, as a thing to go and watch to play that Malik character. I mean, they were drawing on all of that.
It's a great movie all the way.
It's a great movie and it's a terrific performance. So I actually bore him in mind when I read for the part, and true enough, when I got to the set, they were like, yeah, that's a great idea. Just let's try and bring some of that to it. But it was, yeah, you know, going to work at Paramount and working on Star Trek. And there was one day where we had to leave the studio by the back door. And so there were less people around on the floor. So I thought, yeah, I'm going to do it. So I took a detour and went onto the bridge. And the down lights were on, the working lights of the studio were on. But the bridge was live, the lights were all. And I was like, I've got to do it, I've got to do it. So I had a look around. And I sat down in the captain's chair, Captain Archer, Scott Bakula, the wonderful Scott Bakula. I sat back like that and I was like, this is amazing. And just as I got up, I was like, oh no, there was a security camera in the corner of the studio. So somewhere in the archives at Paramount, there's footage of me going, oh, hi, sorry, you know. But yeah, dream come true stuff. And again, the brilliant thing about coming and doing something like this, I haven't done one of these for about 20 years, is that you get to reappreciate the impact that some of that stuff has on people. You know, it's really a part of their lives, fans, you know. And that's not to be messed with, because without that, none of us would have any work anyway, you know.